Reaching the peak of the football world can be bittersweet. On one hand, you've proven you're exceptional, you stood out among the rest, but on the other hand, it is now more likely than ever that your performances will only get worse. On the 13th of July 2014, Joachim Löw asked his wonder kid Mario Götze to show him he was better than Messi. 23 minutes later, he scored one of the greatest goals in the history of German football. This would be a badge of honor he would carry forever. Unfortunately, Götze would crumble under the weight of his own achievements. And today, I'll tell you just why that happened. So, stay tuned. And before I go on with the video, I'd like to ask you just one thing. I don't say it enough and I've been trying to make sure to mention it in every video now, but if you could please like the video, it is like the best way possible to help the channel. And of course, if you're new, subscribing will keep you updated with every video that I posted. I promise you won't regret it. Every week I just try to bring you the best content I can possibly make. So yeah, getting back into it. Götze was born in 1992, he had two brothers and his family was extremely religious. His mother stayed at home while his dad, the sole provider of the household, carried out his duties as a college professor. Being born in Memmingen meant he was at the center of the Bayern scouting network, and as he started joining his friends playing at Ronsberg, Bayern quickly got a hold of him. As a 6-year-old, Götze was already impressive. Although he even got to wear the Bayern colors for a while and discussions for how he would enroll in their academy had started, all would fall apart as his father got a job at another university. Once they moved, his father would sign him up to play at Eintracht Hombruck, trying to emulate the life he would have with Bayern. Regardless, the other kids would be no match for him, so he would join Dortmund in 2001. By the time he was 16, Jurgen Klopp would start managing Dortmund's main team, and as soon as he decided to check up on the youth players, he was in awe of Götze. In his own words, he was counting the days until he could promote him, without being responsible, of course. And so, midway through the following season, after Götze earned the Man of the Match award at the Under-17 Euros after leading Germany to beat the Netherlands in the final and win the whole competition, he started playing with the Dortmund first team. Back then, it was still a novelty. It seemed as if Klopp wanted him to get a sense of how it felt to be in the big stage, without actually putting him under the pressure to perform. But the following season, it all changed. Götze was deployed by Klopp 41 times in a season. From the get-go, Götze was great, and by January, his 4 goals and 7 assists as an 18-year-old were enough to inspire confidence in this young man. But then, as Dortmund were knocked out of every competition and were left to focus on the Bundesliga only, Götze exploded on the pitch, getting 13 goal contributions in 15 matches. These numbers are not normal on an 18-year-old playmaker, and extraordinary numbers get you extraordinary results, in this case, the first Bundesliga title for Dortmund since the turning of the century. At the time, Matthias Sammer called him one of the best talents Germany has ever had. Everyone was rightfully expecting Götze to take everything to the next level the following season and assert himself as one of the best players in the world. He would start the season averaging a goal contribution every 77 minutes before being suspended for 2 matches after a red card. Then, his numbers would drop a bit, but nothing alarming until everything came crashing down as Götze's hip started giving signals of what was to come. Every time he played, his hip would get swollen and stop his movements. There was no solution except to rest, and so he went nearly 5 months without playing. He would still manage to play a few matches before the end of the season, and thankfully, much due to Lewandowski's incredible performances, Dortmund would win the league once again. This could look worrying, but the following season would bring something truly exceptional. Marco Reus joined Dortmund, and together with Götze, he formed one of the most impressive young partnerships of their time. And of course, Lewandowski up front wasn't hurting their chances of making history. Considering that the two of them were involved in 47 goals in the 34 Bundesliga matches of the season, it's hard to understand how Dortmund finished the year 25 points behind Bayern. But honestly, if there was any doubt that they were truly exceptional, the Champions League was more than enough to show they were. Götze's group stage was remarkable. He took part in 5 matches and got 6 goal contributions, including an hat-trick of assists against Ajax and 1 in each match against Real Madrid. Then, he had a goal and 2 assists to send Shakhtar back home in the last 16. And though he would get a blank against Malaga, once he met Real Madrid in the semis, he would torture them once more, getting another assist as Lewandowski won with Bayern in the final of the Champions League. We can only imagine how it would have been if we got to see Götze pair up with Reus and Lewandowski against them. His teammates tried hard, and even though Gundogan would tie the match at one point, the other magnificent and far more experienced Bundesliga duo composed of Robben and Ribéry would pair up once again to get a last-minute goal that would stop Dortmund from becoming champions of Europe. What I did left out of this chapter is that as Dortmund met Real for the first time, there was a bad feeling roaming around the locker room. Just a day before, Bayern had announced they had triggered Mario Götze's release clause and that he was about to join them the following season, becoming the most expensive German player of all time. Klopp was upset at the timing and perhaps jealous of the motive. Götze moved not because he didn't enjoy playing with Klopp, but because his dream was to play under Guardiola. Due to his stature and ability on the ball from a young age, Götze was compared with Messi, and to play under the man who shaped Messi into perhaps the greatest player of all time was not just a dream, it was an imperative in Götze's career. Despite having been part of last year's losing side in the final of the Champions League, this move to Bayern allowed Götze to play in both the Club World Cup and the European Super Cup, in which, despite playing only a few minutes, he would get to take both trophies. This wasn't a rare occasion in his first season. Götze was still imposing himself in this squad filled with many great talents, and even though he would be on some exceptional form, even managing 21 goals and assists in 19 matches from October to February, which already sounds insane but only gets more impressive once you realize he barely ever played a full match, which means in that period of time he was getting a goal or assist every 66 minutes. Those are literally Lionel Messi level numbers. Guardiola was indeed taking Götze to the next level. By the end of the season, Bayern had won the league and the cup, and Götze had only missed the opportunity to make yet another Champions League final as Real, almost as if to prove a point, defeated Bayern 5-0 on aggregate in the semi-finals. Regardless, the Champions League wasn't the highlight of the season. Germany were traveling to Brazil for the 2014 World Cup, a tournament no one would ever forget, but one that would be especially notable for Mario Götze. At this point, Götze had only played 20 minutes for Germany in international tournaments, so in a way this was almost like his debut at the international stage, and he surely didn't want to disappoint. Right on his second match, Götze scored the opener as Germany surprisingly struggled to get a single point against Ghana, and from then on, he would struggle to get any sort of playing time, eventually even being dropped from the squad in the semi-final against Brazil, something that must have truly hurt as the match would be perhaps the most memorable beatdown in the history of football, with Germany destroying Brazil 7-1. The final against Argentina led to Götze watching from the bench as Messi would time and time again fail to hurt the German defense, and by the 88th minute, as the match remained tied and Joachim Löw took off Miroslav Klose, the all-time World Cup top scorer, this would be an easily questionable move. But as Götze took his place and stopped the cross from Schürrle with his chest before volleying in Germany's winning goal, all doubts died down and Götze became the man of the match, the first substitute to score a World Cup winning goal and the youngest player to score in a World Cup final since 1966. Götze was the champion of the people, the unlikely hero, the biggest stain in the career of Lionel Messi. And so, despite playing only about half the available minutes for Bayern over the entire season, the hype around Mario Götze's name was so immense that he would be nominated to the Ballon d'Or and be placed 15th in the ranking. At this point, it seemed that at least out of sheer peer pressure, Guardiola would have to succumb and play Götze as one of the main men. But there was a problem, clearly. Pep frequently opted for a 4-3-3 formation, which left no space left for Götze. This squad was filled with incredible talents. If it serves you of any consolation, Thiago Alcantara was also at the time being left to the side, as Guardiola admittedly struggled to give playing time to every world-class player in his squad. A great problem to have, I would say. But Götze's issue wasn't necessarily just that. It thrived in a very specific role that most teams weren't inclined to provide him with, especially given how versatile he could be. So his limitless potential remained elusive and untapped. For a player who had easily gained notoriety for his big game heroics at Bayern, Götze had showed that something was off. In his first year, he failed to register a goal or an assist in the Champions League knockout rounds, and in his second season, though he had kept his great form in the Bundesliga and even showed some promise, getting 7 goals and assists in his first 7 games of the Champions League, Pep Guardiola would choose not to start him in the semi-finals against Barcelona. The second half of this 2014-2015 season was when people started noticing that something was truly wrong with Götze. He went 16 matches without a goal and only managed 1 assist in that same period. Some claimed a poor work rate was the motive, that he was becoming a brat, all sorts of nasty stuff, to be honest. At the time, Götze didn't pronounce himself on what he thought was leading him to underperform, but over the next few years he slowly opened up about it and we would get an understanding of what happened. After 2014, the press coverage was insane. He had gone straight from youthful football sensation to the German Hall of Fame. He felt everyone's eyes were on him. He needed to perform, or he was a flop. He needed to score, or maybe he was just a one-hit wonder. He needed to remain calm, or he was just another football brat acting up. But above all, his already obsessive and perfectionist personality was driven into compulsion. He started feeling like he had to make history every time he came onto the pitch. As someone who has dealt with severe anxiety for a long time, I can barely imagine what it must have felt like. Eventually, Götze would say it himself: "I will never be the old Götze again." Maybe it's not even that he can't, maybe it's that he doesn't want to, and honestly, maybe he shouldn't, at least for his own sake. The following season, a serious hamstring injury would put him out for nearly 5 months. Among all of this, his performances would suffer even more, and he would go on an 8-month dry streak. If there was one highlight from that season for me, it's the match against Wolfsburg. As Bayern trailed behind, Lewandowski came in and scored 5 goals in 9 minutes. The first would come from an excellent through ball by Götze, and the third and fifth goals would both be assisted by him as well. At the end of the match, Guardiola praised Lewa, but also made sure to say that Götze had been immense. I've said time and time again that this is a major trope in football, but of course, after the bad times he had to go through, Götze decided to go back to his first team. This time around, though, it was a bit different. Götze openly admitted that he regretted having joined Bayern, that he saw how the people perceived his exit and it saddened him. He wanted to prove the old fans that he still loved Dortmund. It's sad how at this point it seems like I'm talking about an aging player in his mid-30s, but I have to point out that he was only 24 at this point. Unfortunately, that year he was diagnosed with myopathy, a disease that can cause weight gain and chronic fatigue, something that could explain his lack of fitness over the last few seasons with Bayern. Still, by the end of the season, he had only played slightly over 1,000 minutes and scored twice. Over the remaining 3 seasons at Dortmund, Götze never managed to climb back to the heights he had once reached. He struggled to make the starting 11 and barely ever played a full match. If I had to pick one of his 4 seasons there, I'd pick the third, where he still managed a goal or assist every 160 minutes. Over that time, he did manage to win 1 German Cup, but that was about it. Currently, Götze is playing at PSV. He's 28 years old and joined on a free transfer. It's an odd move, a clear step back, especially considering it is known that he had several offers from top Premier League clubs, but it's a move I understand and approve. He's been getting back in form there. He has 6 goals and 5 assists so far, despite playing outside of his natural role, so who knows what could happen now. I made this video because I truly cared for Mario Götze. Back then, I would always sign him on my Football Manager playthroughs. I just truly found him so cool, and I think so many people relate to this feeling, especially after seeing him play with Marco Reus. They were such a fresh and entertaining duo in an era where football was becoming robotized and automated. Not that I am not a fan of effectiveness, of course. It would be easy to label him as a waste of talent, but honestly, before he even turned 24, he had already left his mark on the game, so the word waste sounds too harsh. It was amazing. He could play anywhere up front. He was fast, skillful, with an eye for an incredible pass. Many players have gotten claims that he were the next Messi, but not all of them sent Messi walking down the loser's pathway in a World Cup final. His career has a lot of charm. It's an impressive story, a big what if. The day Beckenbauer proclaimed him as the German Messi, you just knew you were in for a blockbuster of a career. So yeah, this was Mario Götze's career in a video. Really interesting player, kind of different from the usual video I make. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed. If you did, don't forget to like and subscribe. And yeah, I'll see you next week. Bye.